is my normal sitting anyway. I'm sitting like this. Right. This is it. Cross-legged and on the bed and running computers.
Right, that's it.
So anyway, how I learned how to play, or how I got led to the drums. Well, my brother, his name was Buster, or Earl C. Smith. We called him Buster. I never did find out what the reason for that was. But anyway, Buster was 18 years my senior. So when Buster was born in 1932, jazz was coming in. And naturally, that was the music of the times. So naturally, that was the music that he came up with. Mm. So all my life, when I was born, I heard this music because my brother was a drummer and a very good one at that. And he was playing with all the cats of that time. He used to bring them cats by the house because it was basically for them. It was hanging out and doing the same thing I would do with some of my musician friends. Hanging out with them, and everybody had the instrument we would play. So that's what they did. They played. I remember he was in the Air Force band. That's when they had the jet planes flying and splitting apart. And then they had them girls marching, saluting. And then they all of a sudden you saw the spotlight hit my brother. He was up there playing the drums, the big band stuff with the band. So I basically came up in that music. And he took me to the drums when I was about 2 years old because I had a way of throwing a temper tantrum if I wanted to go downstairs. And it seemed to me that if I tried to go downstairs, I would fall downstairs. So what I would do is I would fall out on the floor and kick and scream until somebody would stop doing what they was doing and take me down them stairs where all that noise was at. But that was the drum set that I wanted to be around, that thing. So I went down there and I can remember standing underneath his hi-hat. I was little enough to stand underneath that hi-hat while he practiced. And I was able to look and study all that stuff he was doing. I asked myself a lot of questions, you know, all kinds of questions when I was learning how to play the drums. How was he getting that sound so light? But his foot was so big. I think if you had a big foot, you had to have a big old sound. But he had a big old foot, but his stuff was delicate. It didn't sound like boom, boom, boom. It was. So what I did was I carbon copied my brother. I watched what he did as play. But he was actually practicing that way because at night he was going to New York playing the Five Spot and playing them different places. And at that time, jazz was really, because I was born in 49. So by 1952, jazz was banging. It was where rock and roll is now. Just like where pop music is now, the cats winning. Jazz was big like that. New York had went like crazy. Swing and, you know, dance. And, you know, the bebop came out, it was a little different because it was more like you had to know where it was at. It was almost like a musician's music because the cats, we knew where it was at. The people didn't always know where it was at. So Buster came through that. So naturally, me being his brother and starting playing drums at 2 years old, you know, back in those days, they had the, more so like today, they got the computer and everything. You could see the catalog video and or you could hear the CD and all that. Back in my day, it was the record player. Buster used to get down there and play with them records. Mm-hmm. Play with them cats that was the known cats of that time. What they played, learning how to play with that. So I watched him do it, and when he got up from the drums and went to New York to do what he did at night with the music, I sat down and put the record on. Put the record on for 20 years, playing every day and not worrying about when was I gonna get there. Just playing every day and feeling good with it.
How was it to work with Sun Ra?
Mysterious. You know why it was mysterious? Because with Sun Ra, I learned how to feel and go with that feeling. See, he knew how to, Sun Ra knew how to flow. That's really swinging.
Yeah.
That's swinging just like training him. But it's like you get there. It's, the time is so good and so perfect. You just be up there floating.
Yeah.
And it still be swinging.
Yeah.
So I learned how to do that with Sonny, because Sonny liked me. I don't care what the other people say. There's videos that prove it. With me on drums in there, and it's them playing with all the rest of the drummers they got. I'm different. It's something that makes me a little bit, it's different.
How long did you play with Sun Ra?
I played with Sun Ra probably about 10 or 15 years. You know, I feel like, you know, you go around and you try to play with as many masters as you can.
Yeah.
To cut your teeth, to get your playing where, because only the masters are going to put it on that level way. Because when they come in and you count the tune off, they're already at the master level. When they come in on one, they're already at the master level. So I went around, I played with Archie Sheff. I played with, even before Archie Sheff, I played with Lobo Falana. That was the show shit, playing the show tunes and all that. Then I played with, over there, I played with a lot of different cats, Art Farmer. I didn't play with none of them cats on no real official dates, but I'm different. Whenever I sit down, that's when I'm going into it. So it don't have to be in Madison Square Garden, it don't have to be in front of a whole lot of people and all that. I'm different. I tell them all the time, my students know it. If don't nobody come, I'ma play the highest level. And if everybody come, I'ma play the highest level.
Right.
So no matter what they do, if a fine woman come and look my way, I'ma play the highest level. And if she come by and don't look my way, I'm still play the highest level.
It doesn't matter.
But it because I'm playing for something that's bigger than people. Yeah. I'm playing for that spirit that's up in them.
Yeah.
So every time I play, it's new. It's like a new adventure for me, even though I've been doing it 60 years. I've been doing this shit 60 years and I can do it falling down. But the thing is, it's always like a new adventure. That's why I don't let my cats do none of that rehearsing or none of that. You've been a master for 50 years. When I call it, let's go.
Yeah.
That's the way it is. And if you can do that, you can do that. I can do that with folk too, you know. Right. It's just, I'm teaching right now, a lot of my boys, I'm teaching them bebop. So when I get on that, I binge on that. I let them soak up in just that. Now, if they want to do something else on the other side on themselves, they can do it. As long as they don't forget what I taught them, when they come back, they can produce it again and again and again and again. And they get better. Because I got these boys playing with masters. I'm bringing them to the house.
Right.
Yeah. All my videos are like that. No, I don't think nobody's ever done what I'm doing. Because ain't nobody just going to give up no 48-track studio and just open it up and let people just come on in and record.
Yeah. What would you say is the difference between being a musician and teaching music?
Well, teaching music, see, I feel like this. A cat that can play well can teach. If he wants to. It's a lot of if he wants to. Because me, I choose to learn something and give it right away. Now, the reason I do that, when I do that and I give it away, I get it right back. Bam, 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 bam.
Yeah.
I'm living on cloud nine. I put out what I want to put out.
Yeah.
Want to put it out. I don't have to go and ask nobody. Ain't nobody higher up than me.
Shouldn't be anyway.
But I'm easy. If the cats learn how to play and don't waste my time, then they can get in any end of the music they want to get in with me riding downhill with them. Because I'm having fun. I'm 62. I'm having fun riding down the hill.
Hmm.
I've been to the top of the mountain, but let's go again, because now we got the recording studio and we got all this shit. Let's go again, and we can do it this time. And this is all a teaching tool, what I'm doing. It's really a teaching tool, because if it wasn't, I wouldn't put my students in it. I make them play with the masters, because they can only be judged by somebody that's been playing long as me, who ain't gonna fall down under the pressure and all that. The right. students always fall down.
Right.
So you gotta get the cats that's the body of the cats. Mm-hmm. That gotta be some masters that been playing long as Boogaloo Smith. Then it ain't nothing bad gonna happen to the music, because the masters ain't gonna let it happen.
Right.
So students got to play hard. He's got to play. He's got to extend himself and play really.
Dig deep.
To be able to hang with them cats.
Got
to
dig deep.
Yes. And that's what they got to do when they come to my session. Except it's a jam session like everybody else, but I got to record. I got professional recording equipment to record it and capture it. That's what it is. And when you can do that freely, it don't matter if it got the funk beat or the jazz beat. It ain't the funk beat and it ain't the jazz beat. The funk beat and the jazz beat, that's really one thing.
Right.
So jazz is really a collage of all the people that came through Congo Square, them early people. And it was like a melting pot down there, and people mixed.
Yep.
That's what it is.
Yeah.
It's the people that look like they Creole, real light skin or white looking. And it's real to real dark. And everybody in between that, it's all of them people. And they all made that melting pot and mixed and all that. Yeah. That's what it is. Everybody had a different way of hitting something, or a different sound, or a different jump. It's like a melting pot of people.
These characters.
Playing music.
These characters that really molded it, kind of made it, and kind of brought it out, the root of it.
Yes, because it was all kinds of people trying to work in New Orleans in the regular whatever kind of work they was doing. But in all them speakeasies and clubs, they had bands in there.
Yeah.
And the bands was made up of the Creoles, the ones that look like they white, but they really black, but they look white.
Yeah.
And it was made up of the ones that are brown, and the ones that's kind of yellowish like Spanish.
Yep.
All the people came in through New Orleans. And then they might have went other places. They might have went someplace else after that. But basically, they came from there, and they made that music. That music is like the best feeling out of each of these cultures of people. And they brought all this shit. It's like they put all this shit in a pot. Yeah. It was like a gas soup. And they had, and everybody had this, had like a different kind of vegetable or something to put in this, to make it better. And everybody put the thing in there. That's how the music really came about.
Some real gumbo.
Yes. So when you look at the democracy of the country, and then you look at the democracy of musicians, it's different, because the democracy of musicians works, because each part of the party is trying to do something to make the song sound a little better.
So you're forced to work together, really, then.
So yeah, so this guy, he played something that doesn't try to make the song sound right. The other guy took it from there and made it better.
Right.
Then the next guy made it better. Right. And they keep on trying to make this song better with their solos, or the way they're expressing in the horn or whatever, or the way they sing a note. And because they do that, they end up working together. But see, that shit that they got in Washington, that don't work, because money is down there.
Yeah.
And it's because whoever's making the lowest amount of money, there's somebody making the top money too.
Right.
And when it gets up there, it gets real hush-hush.
Yep. It's like the money creates a kind of wall, which you don't have in music, because when you're just on the stage, it's just, you know, thinking about, you know, how much you're getting paid afterwards. You have to concentrate on the music. There's just no space for that.
Yeah. Musicians are trying to, when we play something, it's like a painter, he'll go and he'll paint a thing. But when musicians play, it's like you might have a drummer. Then you got a trumpet player. Then you got a piano player. And say, man, what you want to play? Say, key is so and so and so. So everybody know the key. The key is a rule. Everybody got that rule. And now we all dive in this water.
Yeah.
But we all trying to make the water look more beautiful with the sound of this song that we're singing together. Yeah. That's why music works, because everybody's working together. Ain't nobody lagging, and ain't no bottom man and all that.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? Ain't no bottom man. He's the bottom man, and he ain't making no money, but everybody else is making $10 million. Music don't have that.
Yeah.
It's like a common goal to make this thing sound good.
Yeah. Under true musicians, that's how it works.
Yes.
Yeah.
Now they got a lot of stuff out of the day where cats can't play because they didn't understand what the old cats was doing. The cats that was the generation before me.
Yeah.
They didn't understand that. So you got all these drummers out here now. All of them sound the same. They ain't got that personality thing like Roy Haynes and them cats had. Them cats had a personality when they hit the drum. These cats ain't got none of that because they didn't understand that the old lesson. The lesson that they should have learned with me, they didn't learn it.
Yeah.
Because if they learned that lesson, stop thinking of jazz as some kind of alien music that exists over here in this old time, because it's the base of what they doing.
So it's here anyway.
It's the base of what they doing.
Yeah.
Now, when I play funk, it's so funky, you say, how is he playing? And I ain't playing all that. I'm just swinging. I'm swinging so hard it's like breaking your neck.
Yeah.
That's what it's really about.
Yeah.
That time swinging and all that. Yeah. Whether it's funk, because that's what made James Brown so bad.
Right.
That band was swinging. That band wasn't like these kids out here just banging.
Yeah.
Them cats is playing, man.
Had a flow.
That shit is, man, listen, James Brown swinging. Yeah. Go back and listen to any of that stuff. Cold Sweat. That's swinging.
Of course.
That ain't what these boys are doing. Now these boys are doing a whole lot of playing loud and going around the drums. That ain't playing the drums. Drums is communicating and all of that.
It's just a blur, isn't it?
It's communicating. It's communicating.
Yeah.
I mean, that's what they used it for, really communicate. And when you playing on a bandstand, you are communicating with them people in the audience.
Right. And that is the root of the drum. The root of the drum, it was a communication tool.
Communication.